right, Mr. Williams, thank you so much for allowing us to come in your office and talk to you for a little bit. Really appreciate it. It's been, what, a year and some change now?
A year and about a half since we first took office.
Time flies when you're having fun, right? Something like that. For you, on in honest opinion, like, how would you rate yourself personally of how this first year and a half has been so far?
You know, I don't know how I would rate myself other than to say we have put 150% in every single morning, late nights, weekends. Since judges have allowed us to try jury trials across the street, I was on pace for trying one a month, and those were all successful. So if I look at those standards and compare that to other cities in this country in the middle of a crime surge or other DAs who have sat in this office, I know we're putting in the effort, and I know that we are being strategic. And so I would rate this office as delivering for the people of the city higher than any other office in the past. When you talk about doing it right and doing it fair.
You talk about doing it right and doing it fair. What has your challenges been? I mean, of course, when you came in, you know, dealt with the pandemic and other issues. How did that impact the things that you promised the people to do when you got elected?
Darryl, if I'm honest with you about what it felt like and what it's been like in the first year, it was literally like wading in floodwater to get to work every day. The pandemic alone gave us a backlog, sometimes some cases, violent cases, with victims who have been hanging in there with the DA's office for 5 years, 2 years, really long periods. And this is pre-COVID-19. We did not know what it was. So all those cases got put on hold when jury trials were suspended. And then you add to it all of the violent crime cases and other types of cases, other low-level cases that happened during the pandemic, right? All that just kept stacking, right? And it would be one thing if there was the same DA from the beginning of that time through the pandemic, but when you've got a transition, regardless of who that person is, it's me in this particular case, we came into a shop that frankly didn't have the systems in place. There was not an electronic case management system, and so everything is being handled by paper. You may recall back when I was on the city council, we asked for some data and some information from the DA's office, and it was delivered in fish boxes. Pieces of paper in seafood boxes. So there weren't systems in place. The management structure wasn't solid for a 21st century prosecutor's office. It would be good for a smaller office, but with more than 300 employees, with the case backlog we had, not having an electronic case management system, having people who weren't sure who their supervisor was or what their daily role and weekly role needed to be and how to prioritize certain types of cases, it was like wading through floodwater every single day, just putting the right people on the right seats on the bus and putting a system in place that could run effectively. So it has been a challenge and continues to be.
All right, fast forward now. It's September 2022. Where are you guys at now, and do you believe that you have enough staffing to meet the demand? Talk about the backlogs, the other challenges you took when you got in office. Where are you right now, and do you believe you have the staff currently enough that's able to move with these cases forward?
So we have worked very quickly and very efficiently to grow the deficient areas that existed that we found, right? In terms of victim witness support, these are the people, these are our team members who spend time with victims, survivors, and witnesses of crimes from the time that we get that case referral to when that case goes to court and then beyond. And so we had to double that division for the amount of work that we had because of that case backlog. And so we've got more, but still not enough. When I came into office, many of the 12 sections of court across the street at Tulane and Broad only had one lawyer managing all of those cases. And so we've grown that division as well. There was no civil rights division. There was no one to deal with non-unanimous juries. There was no division committed to cases like the Cardale Hayes case, the case involving former Saints player Will Smith, to deal with Ramos cases, to deal with post-convictions, the same way. We had an appeals division, but we didn't have a civil rights division. We created that division for the first time. We went after federal grants and grants from the philanthropic community, and we're able to generate more than $2.5 million in the first year alone. So we have made some very quick changes to make our operation more robust. But Darryl, you hit the nail on the head with your question. We are nowhere close to where we need to be to deal with this crime surge that we're in right now. Rome is burning. Crime is through the roof. Truancy is off the charts. When I talk about truancy, I'm not talking about kids skipping school. I'm talking about chronic truancy in elementary schools and high schools. Some schools are reporting, and I meet with Dr. Avis Williams. Thank God we have her here. She's great, the new superintendent. Meet with members of the school board. And there are some schools that have 40% of their kids not back in-person learning. And you and I both know if a kid is not in his seat in school, he's in the streets of our community. And we've seen an uptick in crime and violent crime by young people, against young people, and by others. So this is unprecedented.
I got to ask you, back up real quick. You mentioned the whole case about former Saints safety Will Smith. What's the latest on that, and what are you planning to do with that situation moving forward?
The case was set for trial next week. It's been reset to January. It'll probably be one of the first cases that we try in the new year. We stay in close communication with Raquel Smith, his wife, and victim. She was shot in the leg. A lot of people talk about Will's death, but not enough about her being injured in that incident as well. I plan to try that case myself with my chief of trial, Matt Derbys, when it comes back in Section H before Judge Buras, and that case should be happening and moving forward in January.
Okay, thank you for that. And also, moving forward to what you're talking about when it comes to teenagers under the age of 18, as a campaign promise, correct me if I'm wrong, but yes. You said in the past, you know, before you were elected, that when it comes to teenagers, you would not try them as adults.
Right, and that's what I wanted to find a way to not charge young people as adults.
So what changed?
And so what changed was I met with young people. I was in community and trying to figure out why we were seeing this uptick in some of the most violent crimes by young people. There was one case in particular, two young people had high-powered machinery and they shot into the car of Ms. Irvin Levine while she was dropping off food to her parents. Just a ghastly, unconscionable crime. And then they actually, the evidence showed they went, after killing her brutally and her dog, they went and tried to commit another carjacking within moments of that. And so when I started talking to young people to figure out why this was happening, why carjackings and things of that nature were increasing, because you can see there's an uptick in these types of crimes, it became abundantly clear that there were adults, sometimes young adults, sometimes older adults, preying on the minds of young people, encouraging them to commit the most violent crimes, telling them, oh, you will only have to stay in jail until you're 21. And so they're using my campaign promise against me, against the people of this community, and against the brains of young people to have them committing the most serious crimes. And you saw this in Chicago, and you saw this in South Central LA with gangs. And so I thought it was really important to make that pivot, because we all have to evolve. The fact that I thought it could be one way, and I had to reevaluate and reassess that after meeting with young people and figure out how they were being lured into committing some of the most violent crimes, and we had to step in and make a change there.
Some progressives say that's not what you promised us. You're not doing enough when it comes to helping out young people and instead, you know, trying them as adults. What's your response to those who are saying you're not doing what you promised when you got elected?
Well, the first promise is to keep the people of the city of New Orleans safe. And that includes young people. And that's why I visit schools on a regular basis with Councilmember King. That's why just a few weeks ago I was in a meeting in this office, which we hosted with a number of stakeholders in community that for the first time ever included criminal justice stakeholders, business leaders, the NOLA Coalition, and groups like Son of a Saint, founder Vivian Lee, and founder of Youth Empowerment Project, Melissa Sawyer, to talk about how we can prevent young people from committing crimes. And so it was really interesting to have all those people in the room, because when you hear the police department say, when folks call us when their kids are out of control, we have one option. That option is to arrest or to use a citation. And then hearing Sonny Lee from Son of a Saint and Melissa Sawyer offer up other alternatives and interventions to partner with the police to help kids stay out of the criminal legal system, right? So we're working very diligently to keep kids out of the criminal legal system. I do have to say that a big part of that work is outside of the bailiwick, outside of the job description of the DA's office. That's a city lift. That's a group lift. That's why we're working on this truancy initiative with Dr. Williams, because if we can all work together to keep kids in school, we can get better results.
There's a lot of things you said right there that I want to follow up on, but before I get to it, I have to ask you, I haven't really heard your thoughts on this, but what are your thoughts on the governor proposing or wanting to move some of these teenagers to Angola? What are your thoughts on that?
You know, we've got to figure out a way to house all people constitutionally, and that includes young people, that includes our mental health community. You've heard Judge Afric and the sheriff talk about the need to have quality mental health in the jail, this phase three conversation, that's important. Making sure that we have a place that can properly house youth that have committed crimes. Because one of the responses is jail. Jail is on the table when someone has proven that they will hurt someone in this community. Probation, diversion, that has a place. Intervention, mental health, addiction therapy, that has a place. But jail also has a place. If you shoot people in the city of New Orleans, or you shoot people in any parish, you have to go to jail. You have to be removed from society. And we absolutely need the governor's help on this issue. We need the state legislature's help on this issue. And we need a place that can constitutionally and humanely house young people who have to be removed from community. I don't know that Angola is the issue, is a solution to that issue, but it's something we all need to be working on and working on last week.
So you don't believe Angola is the solution?
I haven't studied it enough. I can tell you anecdotally, it is not ideal. It is not a best practice to house young people in the same place that you're housing adults. Oftentimes it leads to segregation and isolation, which is proven to not help people who will re-enter community. When we take people off the grid, off the chessboard, out of community, and we house them in jails, we got to remember some of these people are coming back to community. And we need them to be better than they were when we took them off the board. And so we need to be thinking about that in terms of where they're housed during their sentences.
Absolutely. Now I want to go ahead and move on and talk about those partnerships.
Sure.
Right? How would you describe your relationship with NOPD? Is it a cohesive unit? How is your relationship with Superintendent Ferguson and the folks over at NOPD?
The relationship is better than ever. In fact, I meet with the chief and talk with the chief probably more than I talk with any other agency outside of the sheriff. And that is not just about figurehead to figurehead. That also includes a mandate from my office to cooperate and create longitudinal relationships between the DA's office and the police department. That's from our newest ADAs and the newest police officers, to make sure that we're sharing a flow of information that that helps us in real time make better cases. Now, where the deficits are with regard to technology. We've got to get to a place where the police department and the DA's office can communicate through computers, through technology in real time, when we're storing evidence up on a cloud, so we don't keep having investigators from the DA's office and assistant district attorneys having to go to district to get the evidence we need to bring cases forward. And in like manner, we need technology, better technology for the police department, so they don't have to come here to use a zip drive to transfer the information we need to make with a case, because that's a waste of their time. We want to keep them in community.
There are some folks that were saying that the communication between you and NOPD may not have been the best So now,
they said they were wrong, though.
Because I want to give you time to respond about that. Some folks are saying that there was a sense of miscommunication between you and NOPD. I know that in the past you've said that some journalists were inaccurate about that reporting. What was it that we missed about that?
So what happened was there was robust recording of the one disagreement that the chief and I had on two critical issues. One, it was on I thought we needed to sign an MOU on a multi-agency gang task force. We wanted to bring back aggressive units that were working with the DA's office and the NOPD so that we could tackle this crime surge. And we had an MOU that had been outstanding for about 6 months, and I was pushing to get that signed. And so there's a disagreement about why that was taking so long in the middle of a crime surge. And the other disagreement was just on how cases were categorized in terms of whether or not they were closed or not. And I was just simply saying we should use the FBI data, which meant that a case is closed when a person is arrested, not when the person is identified. But that was just two disagreements out of hundreds of other agreements. So what happened was the press didn't cover the 99 agreed upon tough things that we were working out, but they robustly covered one disagreement. So that really sort of speaks to what happened there.
Okay, absolutely. I wanted to give you a fair Thank opportunity. You. I know in one of the, I think it was on the city council meetings or whatever you called out one of my colleagues, so I wanted to give you a fair opportunity to tell us, you know, what the reason was behind that.
Thank you for that fairness, Darrell. I really appreciate that.
Yeah. Budgeting. Do you think you're getting enough money?
No. We're getting more this year, and I thank the council, and I thank Gilbert Montaño, the CAO, for working with us with such strategic precision to grow certain units like the domestic violence unit and to grow technology and to increase pay for the folks in the office who are working longer hours than they've ever worked before. But no agency is getting what they need right now to properly deal with this crime surge. The Biden administration, I believe, has directed, and I've sat down with Congressman Troy Carter, other members from the White House, Cedric Richmond, who used to be a special advisor to the president, and the $60 million that was sent down to the city of New Orleans and sent down to other municipalities was for us to tackle this crime surge in terms of prevention, policing, and prosecution. And we have not put enough into prevention. I'm talking specifically now. Some of that money should have gone to Son of a Saint Youth Empowerment Project, Daughters Beyond Incarceration, agencies that are helping young people and people make better decisions. But we also need more money coming to this office, because if you have more arrests, then it means you're going to have more trials and more cases. And we need to add an entire separate division, I believe, to get us out of this crime surge. And look, that money can be one-time money. I'm talking about let's put the fire out that is burning in Rome at this moment, and then those resources can go back to the city and be reinvested in Nord and streets and a host of other places.
Did the city council give you like any funding for juvenile programs? And if so, have you utilized those funds to its fullest? Because we've heard that maybe y'all have only used it for one thing and haven't used the full thing. Are you fully using all of the resources that are allocated to you to make sure that you and your team are making sure that these juveniles are off the streets and make sure that they're in the programs they need to do to make sure they're not getting in any trouble?
We absolutely are. We are one of the organizations is Youth Empowerment Project that works with our diversion program. Dr. Pat Watson has been working very diligently with a group of young people as well, and we're able to make those referrals. The thing I will tell you is we're being very, very circumspect, though, about who gets in to what program and what interventions are right. And if someone has carjacked someone, if someone has shot at someone, whether they hit them or not, whether they killed them or not, that violence, that level of violence, I don't believe can be handled out of jail and just through certain interventions. There are times when people need to go to jail, and there are times when people deserve and need interventions, whether it be mental health, for PTSD or for addiction or for low-level nonviolent cases. So we're using those resources. We need more. I had a really wonderful conversation. I would employ you to sit with him as well. Councilmember Joe Geruso is pushing really hard to help us build out a robust continuum of services for young people, from everything from diversion to jail, all of those pieces, right? So it might be mental health counseling. It might be soft skills. It might be tutorials. It might be addiction help. It might be family in need of services help. This exists in Jefferson Parish. Councilmember Geruso is committed to us funding those same programs in Orleans Parish, and I think it can deliver real dividends. But we want to make sure that we are invested in pre-crime, making sure people have the tools they need to succeed.
Okay, thank you for that. I want to pull back just a little bit. We're almost done here. I want to pull back a little bit. I want to talk about you.
Okay.
I got to talk about this.
Sure.
I want to hear what you think about this. I don't want to talk about the trial particularly. That's not what I'm here for. But since the trial has been over and you've beat all the charges, do you feel that it's a big weight lifted off your shoulders? How do you feel now since everything has been moved behind you? Do you feel like there's a something big off your back now that you can move forward with the things you care about? How are you feeling since the trial?
Darryl, if you look at the work that we did in this office, I think it's pretty clear that we were fighting and working in a very unencumbered way. And you look at the hires we made, you look at the number of cases we tried. Since we were allowed to start jury trials again this past March, we've tried over 40 jury trials. You compare that to the 50 or so or less that were tried in 2018 and 2019 pre-pandemic. We have been working very hard and unencumbered, but I got to tell you, as a human being, as a man, it was stressful. And you asked a very real question. How do I feel? I feel more unencumbered and unshackled by those false allegations that I lived under a cloud for the entire first part of my term. I didn't let it slow down the work of this office. I didn't let it stop me from building a civil rights division. I didn't let it stop me from marching into court with my lawyers to try cases or to build a 21st century prosecutor's office. But I got to tell you, it's like if a person was shot with a bullet, shot in the leg, and the bullet was removed, you're certainly relieved and you feel better when the bullet's pulled out, but the pain's still there and there's still some healing. I thank God for Judge Affleck and Judge Feldman for being excellent jurists who were committed to the rule of law and who were committed to the truth and accuracy in their courtrooms. And I'm deeply and forever grateful to this jury for seeing through the smoke screens that those lawyers from Shreveport tried to come down here to New Orleans and put up.
Absolutely. And also, of course, this is nothing new for people in the past, but of course you were hired by the law firm as a civil litigator. For folks out there that are saying, crime's out of pocket, a lot's going on, can you reassure them that this won't be a distraction for your day-to-day job as the DA of Orleans Parish?
Absolutely. So if you look at just statistics on this thing, most DAs throughout the state, since before I was born, have maintained a civil practice or had their name on the shingle of a civil practice. Just look at it and look at the math on it. I have been here almost every single day and night. I have tried more cases than any of my predecessors personally. I've tried more cases in court before juries than most prosecutors in this country. So people need to rest assured that Jason Williams is here early and here late doing the work of holding people accountable across the street. And I also want to set the record straight. That was an effort at true transparency. We were talking about what was going to happen a date in the future. I have not joined that firm as of yet. It was a letter I sent to Judge Pittman. I'll get Curtis to share it with you. That's not a formalized process yet. That was just me, just like we created dashboards showing the work that we're doing in this office so the public can look. That of counsel arrangement hasn't happened yet. I am here this morning. I'm going to be here tomorrow morning. And we're going to get out of this crime surge. And it's going to take my dedication and the people can rest assured that just like they've gotten that the first 18 months, they're going to continue to see that.
And I had to ask. That's a big question folks, want to know, because we're living in some odd times right now because of the crime rates. They want to make sure that is one of your main focal points in this office. So thank you for answering that. Also, I got to just kind of pull back the curtain a little bit.
Okay.
I got to ask you this. You know, we're all human. You know, we're proud of some things we've done, and sometimes we're not so proud. Is there anything that you're like, I could have done this a little bit differently? Anything during your tenure?
Yes, I think when the decision was made by the criminal court judges to shut down jury trials for over a year, that was a unilateral decision. It didn't include the mayor, the city council, the police chief, the sheriff, or myself, or the public defender's office. I believe that should have been a bigger public fight. I believe that should have been a bigger public fight.
Why so?
Because the rate of spread of the virus, and I understand the position that the courts were in. They didn't want to bring people together to try cases because we were trying to suppress the virus and keep people socially distant. That was public safety. Crime is public safety. And not having that tool that every other DA in this country and this state had for such an extended and protracted period, I think has caused serious problems in the administration of justice. Just like when floodwater came in and courts were closed after Katrina. And if I had to do all over again, I think I would have drawn a line in the sand and said that if jury trials were moving forward in other parishes, then they needed to move forward in Orleans Parish too, because we had more crime. And so when I look back, and as you said, Darryl, we're all human, and you're probably one of the few reporters that pushes back on pulling back that curtain and looking at things that we could have done better. That's one that I think I should have pushed harder on. I think I should have pulled up Lauren Lampard from the LDAA and some other folks from other parishes to say, look, we're doing it. Y'all got to do it too. Because the chief has said it before. I see it. Look, you cannot do the job completely without all of your tools. And a jury trial is what you need in the toughest cases, murder, rape, armed robbery. And since we've started these trials, you look at our conviction rate, you look at the former success rate in the past, and you can see that we're able to deliver. And so that's a big thing that keeps me up at night.
Finally, in 2023, 2024, what is your vision for your office in the next couple of years? What is the biggest things that you're really hoping to accomplish and what your future is for your office moving forward? What's your biggest hope?
My biggest hope is that we continue to grow the talent in this office and we finally get this DA's office in a place where we're creating career prosecutors. This has been a place that's been a bit of a revolving door for years because of the amount of work it takes to work here. This is the only courtroom that's trying cases every single week. Every other parish has weeks on and weeks off from criminal responsibility, right? And so I want to grow the talent pool and keep them. But I also want to grow a unit that is just handling murder cases, right? With seasoned prosecutors that are just focused on that. And I hope that we can work with the city council to develop that. Because that's not just our biggest area that needs to be focused on. Domestic violence, sex crimes. These are areas that are typically underreported and have not been priorities in this country or in the city. And so I want to grow those divisions so that we can finally start really delivering justice in those areas, because those areas have been underlooked. And so I believe we can do that well and we can do it right, but it's going to take more resources and more people. And I think 2023 will be the year to do that, especially with federal dollars coming down that have never existed in this way in the past. That's always been the big issue. Got to do more for less. But now that we're in this crime surge and we have resources, I think if we use them wisely at the end of 2023, we can have better technology between the police department and the DA's office than we've ever had. And we can have better woman power and manpower in both agencies.
Hey, thank you so much for answering the tough questions and also answering the behind the curtain questions, Mr. Williams.
Daryl, thank you. And big shout out to my my Green Wave former team member, Kendall Francis, over there at WDSU for setting this up and always making sure that we're getting in touch with the media to make sure we're communicating well.
Absolutely.